friends, welcome to the fascinating world of theatre. In this episode, we will continue with the interesting topic in theatre, that is Asian theatre. Now let us see trans rituals in Asia and we will talk about the animal movements. The tradition of imitating the movements of animals seems to stem from the earliest periods of known human existence, that is, the times when humans were hunter-gatherers and their entire livelihood depended on the natural world and the animals around them. Indeed, the earliest known artifact showing a man imitating an animal has been found in a Stone Age cave in France and is dated to approximately 15,000 BC. It depicts a man clothed in animal fur and wearing the horns of a deer. His pose clearly imitates the movements of a deer. Man was a hunter during the early Stone Age. Thus, it is no wonder that the majority of Stone Age cave paintings depicts animal. Their function has been widely speculated about, and most experts seem to argue that they had a magical function. There may also have been a more practical reasons for the imitation. With this primitive weaponry, it was very important for the hunter to get close to animals. Once the hunter was able to imitate their movements, it was possible to get nearer the animals without frightening them. Thus, there may be several reasons why early man imitated the movements of animals. Dance anthropological studies have pointed out that these animal movements may in fact represent the origin of human dance. Animal movements still form today an integral part of the training series of different martial art techniques, which animals were or are imitated naturally depends on the fauna of each geographical region. As mentioned already, in the sphere of Nordic shamanism, the animals imitated were the bear and the deer. The popularity of animal movements is not limited only to archaic traditions. Even the charm of the most popular of all Western classical ballets, Swan Lake, is based on the fact that there its great white scenes, the movements of the ballerines, aim to capture the essence of a swan's being. Martial arts. As it has been already pointed out that most of the Asian theatrical traditions are performed by stylized dance-like movements. Many of these intricate movement techniques have developed during many centuries, even millennia. They include several different elements such as symbolic hand gestures, fixed ways of standing and sitting, sculpture-like poses and defined ways of portraying, for example, a battle. Many movements, particularly those related to fighting, can be traced back to ancient martial arts and weapon worship. Most of the Asian cultures have their own sophisticated martial arts symbols, also known now in the West, such as the Chinese Taiji, the Kala Rat Paitu, and Thangta of India, Thai boxing, the Silat of the Malay world, and the Japanese Kendo and Judo, etc. Many of these martial systems have a very long history. For example, the Chinese traditions can be traced back to periods before the present era, from animal movements to martial arts. The existence of so many animal movements in the present martial arts systems is a clear indicator of the long history of martial arts. It is possible that the ancient animal movements of prehistoric periods formed a kind of basis on which the martial systems were later developed. Thus, it is often through the martial arts that animal movements also found their way into theatrical traditions. Basically, the martial arts traditions can be divided into four groups. First is those rehearsed with the weaponry. Second is those executed without weaponry. Third is those rehearsed in groups or by couples. Fourth is those rehearsed alone as a kind of solo form. The weapons vary in different traditions. They usually include traditional weaponry such as spears, sticks, swords, daggers, etc. The original function of the martial art was no doubt to practice the skills of combat and self-defense. The arrival of firearms, of course, reduced their original function, and many of them developed into kinds of psychophysical training methods that focused on mental and physical skills, self-discipline, and mental harmony. These kinds of meditative and magical aspects may have been present in many of the martial arts traditions, even at a very early stage. From martial arts to dance and theater, most of the Asian martial arts techniques have clear ritualistic features, and they share the movements and poses, such as the open leg position with the dance tradition of the region where they evolved. Martial art techniques have influenced Asian dance and theater traditions deeply. In fact, when martial arts are isolated from their original function, fighting and or self-defense, and are shown either as a part of a theater or dance performance or an independent martial arts demonstrations or performances, they bear similarities to dance performances. Although martial arts as such are rarely regarded in Asia as a form of art, one could simplify the process of how the martial arts became part of the theatrical arts. It is as follows. Firstly, they were adopted as rituals, such as, for example, the Balinese war dance, Baris, which was originally performed before the warriors went to the war. Secondly, they were adopted into classical traditions because the performers, for example, members of the court and its bodyguard, had the basic knowledge of them. Later, when grand court theater forms evolved, including also great battle scenes, the martial arts provided an already established movements vocabulary that was already familiar for both the performers and the audience. Many of the Asian classical traditions include martial arts techniques even today. The well-known grand scale examples include the Kathakali of India, the Khon of Thailand, and the Kabuki of Japan. Probably the best known example in the West is the Chinese Peking Opera. In fact, a Peking Opera actor studies these skills from the beginning of his or her training and continues to develop these skills further if he or she is specializing in many of the Peking Opera martial role types. Now, the art of storytelling. So far, mainly the physical aspects of the origins of Asian theatre traditions have been discussed, such as the trance rituals, animal movements, and martial arts. If we consider the textual and narrative aspects of Asian theatre, it is obvious that the origins can be traced back to the simple act of conveying a story to the audience orally. This kind of storytelling traditions can still be found in abundance in Asia today. For example, in the Islamic world of West Asia, in China, in Korea, etc. Many of the later theatrical traditions such as shadow theater, puppet theater and many of dance theater forms evolved from early storytelling traditions. Indeed, in Asia, the storytelling traditions served at least partly as the starting point from which the complex theatrical performances based on the same oral and later written material developed. The process could roughly be outlined as follows. This is the first. The starting point is the act of storytelling, that is, the act of conveying the oral literary tradition. Second point is, gradually, the storytellers started to employ different kinds of visual devices to illustrate their narration. Panels, scroll paintings, shadow figures, puppets, and in some cases even dolls. Third, storytelling was enriched by gesticulation, body movements, mime, dance, music, etc. During this process, the act of storytelling became more theoretical in character, and the narrative traditions and performing arts cross-fertilized each other, which resulted in many of the present classical theatrical forms. Just to give some example, the Wing Wong dance drama of Java is believed to have developed from the Javanese Wing Kul shadow theater, in which the primus motor of the whole genre is a dialogue puppeteer who is also the storyteller in the performance. Sometimes, during the history of the process, live actors came to replace the puppets. The background to the corn mask theater of Thailand seems to be a similar case. In this, the narrators take care of the storyline and dialogue, while the actor dancers gesticulate according to the narrations. The Japanese Bunraku puppet theater, for example, developed when the puppeteers in the 17th century started to cooperate with the so-called Jorori storytellers, who still dominate the whole art form with their expressive recitation. The etiquettes and the formulation of the present classical traditions. The term classical is a dangerous one because it is so value laden. Thus, classical art forms can easily seem to represent something more valuable or higher than the non-classical folk or popular forms. In this connection, classical forms generally refer to traditions which evolved from core traditions and which were added during the beginning of the 20th century to the curriculum of the state art schools and universities. These traditions are now usually classified as classical dance in their respective countries. Besides these traditions, hundreds of smaller traditions live in Asia, which can be just as sophisticated and intricate as those classified as classical ones. As mentioned above, one could generalize that the present classical form in Asian theater developed roughly between 13th and early 20th centuries. One important feature of mainland Southeast Asian culture has been the conception of the God King. the cult created an extremely intricate court etiquettes, which was also reflected in dance and dance theater, as the performances often featured the gods to which the living king was related. It was natural that the physical surroundings and the modes of behavior of the artistic presentations follows the models set by the king's actual court. Thus, many dance theater forms of the court, especially those in a grand scale, still reflect today the behavioral practice and etiquettes of court. This is not only an Asian speciality. For example, the 17th and 18th century opera, Seria or serious opera, reflected the etiquettes of contemporaneous courts in the rhetoric gestures and elaborate bows and curtsies. Similarly, the Baroque dance was shaped and controlled in the 17th century. French court by King Louis XIV himself, when the Baroque dance later evolved into romantic ballet in the early 19th century. Many of the originally country practices were still retained as kinds of references to bygone days. Similarly, in Asia, many of the conventions such as ways of standing, sitting, kneeling, crouching, gesticulating, saluting, etc., which could now be easily be interpreted as being purely stylized theoretical conventions, can in fact be traced back to actual historical behavioral practices and codes. A theater genre crystallized in classical form is an extremely sensitive and complex whole. It requires the close cooperation of specialists in many forms of art and an unbroken tradition extended over generation. It necessarily reflects the history and ideals of the culture that created it. Theater has often been called living history, and in Asia, this is particularly true. Many of the stories which are enacted with the most elaborate dance-like movements can have histories stretching back hundreds or even thousands of years. Some of the ritualistic features and physical techniques of performances reflect ancient animistic beliefs going back even further in time and even today. The performances can have a profound spiritual and symbolic meaning for both the performers and their audiences. As Asian theatrical genres are such complex constructs, they offer exceptionally wide-ranging approaches. They can be studied or observed from the point of view of literature, since they often enact great epics or dramatic literature of the highest order, as they are usually accomplished by specific musical styles. They offer material for musicologists as well. Their complex dance or dance-like movement techniques can be analyzed by means of dance research or a dance anthropological approach, while the ideologies they propagate can be observed from a philosophical or religious point of view. They also reveal much information about the social histories of their respective countries. So, while concluding this, I would say that the basic aim is to describe the traditional forms of Asian theater and dance firmly in their historical context. It is what they tell or propagate, that is, their literary content. However, as Asian theater genres still preserve their complex, often physical acting techniques, special attention will be paid to the question of how the stories are actually performed and which techniques exactly are used in the process of enactment. Thank you.